Hey.
Hello.
What's going on?
Not much. Just again, this is very classic left and right territory. Wearing a tank top, basketball shorts, sitting in my hot ass room, recording an episode.
There you go.
Feels very vintage
Feel like
left and right.
you've been here before.
Yep.
Right
Yeah, the
on.
cat is stalking in and out of my room, occasionally meowing, wanting to have his head scratched. And then he goes and nibbles on a little bit of food, then he comes over, just back and forth.
Yeah.
Very gluttonous.
That's funny.
Yeah. No, he will do this for the entire hour. He'll just take two bites and come back over here and then just stand under my hand until I scratch him.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
He's such a funny cat.
Yeah, he is Sancho Panza. Of that there is no doubt.
Dude, that rules.
Yeah.
Oh, the browser website. So I have a part of the episode today is going to involve me directing you at the right time to a series of photographs and little blurbs about a particular individual.
Cool.
And I the browser. Yeah, this is it. Okay, perfect. The browser site's just different than the mobile site.
Okay.
I wish I had a Sancho.
Yeah, dude, cats are cool. You should get one.
Yeah, so it's funny, like I started the process of trying to adopt a cat and sent out, you have to send an application to a lot of these shelters. And because of COVID, places aren't, you can't just walk in and see
Be
cats,
like, I
right?
like that cat. It's looking
Yeah.
at me funny.
You have to do everything via remote correspondence. And I don't want to make any assumptions or cast any aspersions, but I have a feeling that the cat people that run the cat ranch aren't the most prompt. I get the sense that you might be kind of a scatterbrained person. So a lot of people I just never heard back from, but it's kind of the cliche right now about having an entry level job and needing 10 years of
Oh yeah,
experience.
no, dude. Yeah, they're like, "Well, do you have a reference from a vet?" You're like, "No, this is my first pet. I would like to own this pet." You're like, "Well, no, you need to before you can own a pet, you've had to have owned a pet."
Right. Yeah. It's like, why would I have a working relationship with the veterinarian? I get
This
all
is
my
my
shit
first
done by
foray.
a people doctor.
Yeah, see that's why I just my friends had a cat that they could no longer keep.
Yeah.
And I took him, and now I have my vet reference. I got kind of grandfathered in,
There you go.
sort
Yeah.
of. I guess grandfathered in wouldn't be the right term there, but I mean, like I schmoozied my way in there. And like, oh yeah, no, this cat that I'm just the guy who has him now. And they're like,
All
oh, that's cool. Yeah, great.
right. What happened to his previous owner? Pancakes by drunk dump truck driver.
That wasn't it, but yeah.
Yeah, no, I know. Yeah, well, you got lucky.
Yep.
There's obviously, I wish I could get grandfathered in.
Yeah.
But
Again, probably not the right term to use there, but
here's the thing. If somebody, I've also had a couple opportunities where I had a friend who had gotten a kitten from a friend,
yeah.
and then their cat was pregnant again. So my ex-girlfriend, whose friend this was like, "Hey, such and such just got in touch with me. Her cat's having more kittens. Do you want one?" And I was like, "Yeah, definitely." And she was like, Cool. It'll just definitely have fleas and worms because all
Yeah.
the kittens do." And I was like, "Well, I don't. If I was living by myself, maybe I'd. But I don't want to bring fleas into the house and have
Yeah,
my
well,
roommates
so
all
a
deal with them."
story with that. So I have a friend, obviously won't use their name, but recently they had gotten a cat as well.
Yeah.
Like this was last year and it was a kitten. And yeah, I mean, until you get them dewormed and everything like that, there's a good chance that they'll have worms, you know what I mean?
Sure, yeah.
Just kind of happens with animals. And so he had obviously been holding the cat and sleeping in his bed, and he was still waiting for the vet appointment. And so worms can transfer from cats to humans, and he didn't realize that, and so long story short, he shit his fucking pants in a pharmacy, like his pharmacy that he goes to all the time. Because all of a sudden, he didn't realize it, and it's uncontrollable when you have worms, so he had to get dewormed as well. But yeah, he was just buying something, and then it was in the summer and just shit himself.
Were there worms in the shit?
I mean, it just ran down his legs, and he had to run out of the store
Because imagine
and
being the
walk
person
home.
cleaning that up and being like, "Yo, there's worms in this."
I probably not at that point.
And wriggling.
He just had to like run out of the store as he's just like liquid diarrhea ink.
Oh my god, that's awful, man. I've never had very that funny full. Story. I've never had that full experience. You know, like in public. I've come close in my own home, but that's another story. I think we've already gone over that.
We've talked about my norovirus episode.
Well-trodden territory.
Yeah, I don't think I need to tell that story again. I had many people reach out after that. They were like, "God damn, dude, that sounds terrible."
Yeah.
And that was in the comfort of my own home.
Yeah. Yeah, you had it bad. I've had, like, little stomach bugs, but I never quite that horrible sounding.
Yeah.
What else? Oh, well...
Well, yeah.
I guess we did say before we start the show, we wanted to kind of talk a little bit about current events.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's kind of tough to be sort of upbeat with... Yeah. I mean, kind of what's happening right now.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's... So, for those of you listening, we're recording this on Thursday, the 26th. You'll have it soon.
By Monday.
Yeah, probably by Monday. Or if not... Yeah, definitely by Monday, because I'm working like a dog before that. But, yeah, so, you know, we're just a couple days out from this most recent sort of tragic... Not sort of tragic, this most recent... tragic shooting that happened in Texas. And this one in particular, I feel like we've been texting a lot back and forth about, because there's, you know, in addition to the sort of obvious tragedy of
horror,
bunch of children being, you know, stripped of their lives, there's this whole secondary element of police incompetence that's like just really to me sort of like gasoline on the fire as far as like how outraged I feel about it.
I mean, yeah, and, you know, it's something that, like, I mean, there's clearly a cover-up happening right now, right? Like, you know, I remember even at the time of, like, there were reports constantly about, oh, the guy's in police custody. He's not in police custody. Right. He's in police custody. He's dead. Ends up, he's dead.
Yeah.
I mean, my guess would be that he got popped in order to shut him up about what happened leading up to it. That's just speculation on my part, obviously. But, you know, reports that, you know, it was to the point that it was about an hour that this individual had been inside of a school shooting fucking children. I mean, as horrible as, like, high school children are, this is, like, I mean, these are young children.
Yeah, they've had, like, no chance to even turn into the person they're going to be yet. They're, little people.
And I would say it is that there's probably no... more obvious symbol of a failed society or, you know, civilization, country, that we can't even protect, you know, our future from ourselves like this. You know, when, you know, 8, 9, 10-year-old children can't go to school without fear that the state, the people in charge of their lives, cannot stop them from being mutilated and massacred at will, and that, you know, there's almost seemingly no institutional desire from anybody in power to affect any sort of change. You know, on the very day that this happened, the Democratic Party likes to pretend like they're, you know, the party that cares about people. Their basic response has been, well, you should vote in November.
Yeah.
And also they were making
a polling thing. It's like,
yeah, they also said, you know, they came out and said, and this is Democrat again, that if there's any legislation, it won't be until after the Memorial Day recess, because goddamn, I don't care if kids are getting shot. I'm going to fucking grill. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's also the fact that at the very same time in Texas, the Democratic establishment was making 11th-hour calls to stop a progressive challenger against Henry Cuellar, who's, like, the most, like, right-wing Democratic member of the House of Representatives. He has an A rating from the NRA. He's also anti-abortion, so, you know, just so you know that those in charge really don't care about that issue either. And, you know, it seemed, you know, I find it difficult to really even articulate just how much of an institutional breakdown this entire thing is, you know, and, I'm somebody who's pro-Second Amendment.
Yeah.
I believe that people should have the right to own guns. Clearly, there needs to be a huge overhaul in the process, and especially, you know, who can purchase guns, when they can.
Absolutely.
The entire aspect of it. You know, I remember visiting a friend in Virginia, and I had never owned a gun. I had never taken any gun safety classes. I had one time at that point in my life shot guns before. And he was just like, oh, yeah, dude, if you just say that you live at my house, they'll let you walk out with a gun today.
Yeah, I was there for the one time you shot guns, because that was the one time I shot guns.
Yeah.
And I was really bad at it. And that's why I don't have a gun. I know I'm fucking ass at that. I'm not...
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a fun hobby that can be done safely, but obviously... Yeah.
And you know, I think there are practical parts to it, too. Like, I get, you know, if you... live in an area where it's necessary. I mean, having home protection, protecting your family and yourself from, you know, whatever. We won't get overly radical here, but
the thing is also, you know, like, we're not the only country in the world that has gun laws like this. I mean, you can go north to Canada, where they have similar gun laws to us, and this doesn't happen.
Switzerland,
which is why the entire, you know, the entire debate on the right, they'll try to talk about how it's mental health, something they've never ever given a fuck about and don't hear. They just use it as a misdirect, and then you have like Democrats who will make a big show about gun control, but it's like the abortion thing, where they'll never actually do anything to implement these because they like to fucking use these as a way to whip their base into fundraising.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And both of them are misdirects because there's clearly something else going on than just, oh, if we just had gun control. No, there's clearly something happening that isn't either of these things, that is much deeper and more horrifying, that we keep doing this to each other and to fucking children. And, you know, I think something like the FBI needs to really get a long look at, because... And I've told you this before, you know, like, oh yeah, wait a couple days, they'll say that they knew the shooter and he was on their watch list. Fucking FBI didn't even wait.
Yeah.
This time. Literally the day of, they're like, we knew this motherfucker.
Yeah.
He was on a watch list. This was preventable. Well, you know, at a certain point, people really need to start there and sit and, like, look at, and how the fuck does every single one of these, are they known by the FBI?
Mm-hmm.
You have certain mass shootings. This one was in Texas. I can't remember the exact one. I can look it up in a second. But an FBI agent was arrested leaving the scene of a mass shooting, and he had messages from his phone to the shooter encouraging them. And how, and you know, you get to ones where there was that teenager in Detroit who was a fucking lonely, depressed teenager, and he was a Muslim, and he had been he had multiple federal agents posing as woman over Twitter DMing him, trying to get him to commit a shooting, and he repeatedly said that he didn't want to do it and that it was wrong, and so they ended up just arresting him anyway on owning a gun that he didn't own anymore and that he had already been arrested with once before, which is how he was known, and they just arrested him for the same thing again. And I think people really need to start asking, why the fuck is it that so many of these people are known to law enforcement beforehand or are encouraged by law enforcement?
Sure.
Because there is something more going on here.
Yeah, and I mean, whether it's, you know, I don't want to get too deeply conspiratorial here, right?
Because yeah, no, me neither.
Ultimately, I think the important thing is right, the human element of this, but
yeah.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, at a certain point, when do you stop and examine the tactics that these law enforcement agencies utilize to quote-unquote catch people? Mm-hmm. And how often do the techniques used to do that actually encourage or create the problem that might not have existed to begin with?
Right.
You know, at what point, like, is the entrapment so severe that you're actually sort of guilty of creating, you know, the person and the situation where this might occur?
And look at the guys in the Gretchen Whitmer kidnapping case, where two of them were straight up acquitted of all charges.
Yeah.
Because it was so obvious that this was, I mean, these guys were stupid and, in my opinion, dangerous.
Yeah.
And they should face some consequences.
Of course,
that.
They
and
were dangerous.
And I think they did. I think the fact that they were jailed and put through trial probably scared them fucking straight. But it's also like, can you say that those guys were likely to do anything if it weren't for
them basically
the federal government
on?
Egging them on. And the reason that they do this is so that they can look like heroes when they stop it, or to get more funding. But, like, I mean, the craziest part with the Gretchen Whitmer one was when there was that one, and you know, I read the transcripts, like the arrest transcripts, like the what went what was entered into court. You know, I had read these FBI documents, and at one point, the guys were in two cars staking out Gretchen Whitmer's house. And the second car was supposed to be looking out to see if they were being tailed by police officers. There were two federal informant or law enforcement assets in the car that didn't know each other.
Yeah.
And it was supposed to be looking out for tails. And two different assets, unknownst to each other, were in that car.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, you know, so this entire idea of, you know, yeah, like, this entrapment, or, you know, trying to wind people up to commit crimes in order to stop them, in order to look like heroes, in order to get your precious little promotion, in order to get more funds, how much of this is, like, also ending up, you know, happening?
Right, and, yeah. And, yeah. What's the tangible human cost of this right. being the and, way and, that you go about, like I said, attempting to entrap someone, but at what
But then
point
what if it goes just, sideways?
Right.
It actually happens.
Well, and the thing is, it obviously does
yeah.
fairly often, and, you know, I don't know. Anyway, yeah, it's a real shame. I mean, we obviously have a tendency to sort of devolve into that, you know, aspect of these big events. That's, I'm sure you can tell by now that that's sort of our thing. It's definitely Evan's thing. But, yeah. again, like, at the end of the day, like, what is it, 19 kids are dead and two adults or something like that?
And it's not the first time. It's 19 little kids.
Little kids.
These are children. These yeah. are
and the again, future of this country. And again, not to say that country, it's right for any innocent person right. to get shot, but like... But,
I mean, like, what the fuck are they supposed to do?
How do you,
they have
how
no
do you,
recourse.
How do you look at this as someone who, you know, accepts money from the gun lobby? How do you look at this and not just feel like the worst piece of shit on the planet? You know, and yeah, and they, somehow the gun cult has got themselves convinced that it's anything but gun control. You know,
well, yeah. Like, I mean, I'm not sure that they have themselves convinced. It's just they make money off of it, so they don't give.
Well,
a
the
fuck.
The politicians, I think, yeah. But I'm also talking about all the people that are just regular Joes like you and me, Joes
oh, yeah.
and Janes and Jerrys. I guess I'll use Jerry as my gender neutral name.
Yeah, that's it.
That they. Foam at the mouth over this stuff and rabidly, you know, I know multiple people that are going to have that opinion, you know, when I go to work next. And,
yeah,
it's so sad that like you can't even be capable of any kind of defensive thinking when something this wretched occurs. And it's like, there are plenty of countries, like you were making, you know, mention of Canada before. Switzerland, you know, has surprisingly lax gun laws. There are lots of gun owners and gun enthusiasts in Switzerland. This doesn't happen there. Japan, you can, believe it or not, you can buy a gun in Japan. But to get a gun in Japan, you have to jump through hoops, man. Like, it is yeah. a prolonged and heavily scrutinized process. You have to get multiple character witnesses from your neighbors. Like, you don't get to pick. They interview your neighbors and shit. And, mm-hmm. you know, if there's any suspicion that you might be some sort of a violent element in society, you're done. Like, you're never going to get one. And, mm-hmm. you know, they have their own problems with violent crime, but nothing on the scale that you see here. Yeah. And that's a heavily populated, densely populated country. You'd think that stuff would happen if that was all it took, was just people being close together, you know, and having yeah. mental health issues. Talk about a country with a history of stressed people going into school and work.
Yeah, so why and America is not that heavily no. populated. At least a no. lot of parts of it aren't. Some are.
No, yeah.
Like, like population density, I mean.
Our coasts are.
But, yeah.
But yeah, that's really it. And so, anyway, I don't necessarily think we need to go too much further into this, but
yeah.
We felt like it was something that had to be addressed because, you know, it's just become such a accepted part of our society and people are so yeah. complacent. You know, I was talking to my dad earlier, like, in any sane society, hearing about something like this should be the worst thing you hear all year. It should be so...
But we've heard it each of the last, like, 3 weeks.
I know. But what I'm saying is, like, you hear...
yeah.
If you hear this...
No, yeah, no, I know what you're saying.
19 children shot to death. I know.
Yeah.
But I'm just finishing
yeah.
my point.
Yeah, yeah.
That should be the most outrageous thing that you can fathom. And instead, it's like, we'll probably forget this specific incident.
Yeah,
or whatever. It'll
in
fade
weeks.
Into the milieu of
yeah.
Other equally fucking wretched things that have happened.
Parkland already happened, so yeah. And it was the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, and I think that's like one of the most insidious parts of this. And I think one of the things that, like, I think it's also really important to sort of organize, you know, community organize politically, organize with other people that are like-minded of you is, like, when I saw this happen, once, you know, I kind of got over, you know, I have a difficult time, like, hearing about, like, children being harmed or hurt in ways like this. You know, I have a pretty kind of tough demeanor. I obviously read about and talk about this stuff a lot just with the podcast, but it's the, once it gets to, like, children, like, little kids, it's very difficult for me. So, like, once that kind of, like, shock and, like, sadness wore away, the only feeling that was left was, this isn't going to change anything. Like, you know what I mean? Like, this helplessness about it is, like, this is just a part of life here. Like, nothing is going to happen. We're going to have the same people say the same things. And then, and that's one of the things, too, like, why I think, like, Democrats really like to go back to, well, you should vote in November, is because come November, you know, for some people, obviously, people that were directly impacted, this will still be painful. But for everybody else, there will have been a million other traumatizing events, you know, like culturally traumatizing, not necessarily personally, but culturally traumatizing events that will forget about this. Yeah. And that it won't have that same visceral reaction within you that it will. And it's kind of like, you know, and that's what was left once you kind of get over the shock of it, is that this is not going to change anything. And that's what's, I think that's one of the most damaging things about this. And that, honestly, sometimes I wonder if this is sort of by design, that, you know, we live in a country that is so consistently traumatized, and small pockets traumatized of people, and, you know, spreads throughout everybody else, that it's like, there was a school shooting last week, there was the Buffalo one 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like every fucking week this shit happens. And it's like, how do you keep up the visceral response when this is just a constant stream?
Yep.
Anyway.
It's emotionally exhausting. So, yeah, and you know what? I was about to spit out some sort of cliche response, but I think for me, the note I'd like to end on is that, like, it's pretty clear that, like, thoughts, or even better, thoughts and prayers, are not really going to fix the problem. And, you know, obviously, I hope you can tell how kind of affected we both are by this. But, you know, there needs to be more concrete action than, you know, folks posting about it on their Instagram stories, which, you know, I'm also guilty of. But at what level?
Most people have.
Right.
It's like, but it's like at what level? We live in a country that everybody empowered does nothing. No matter what we do, everybody in power just tells us to fuck off.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a, what, so I think it was The Onion. They, it was like, yeah, you know, quoting Mitch McConnell, it was like, all right, get your crying and shit out of the way, or whatever the fuck you're gonna do, and then sit the fuck down, because we ain't doing shit. And yeah, it's like, yeah.
No legislation will be discussed until after
right
the Memorial Day recess for the Senate. Our big, beautiful senators are tired. They're very tired. They work 100 days a year, maybe. Mm-hmm. They're very tired, and they just want to grill. It's they're in the grill mindset. You know what I mean?
Yep. Yeah, so that's that. We just wanted to kind of touch base on that a little bit.
Yep.
I promise you the rest of the episode is kind of tonally the exact opposite. So we're going to try to get ourselves out of tragedy mode, and this is kind of a silly one. heavily inspired by our last episode, which was, of course, about Falun Gong. As I was, and, you know, you'll see as we get into the episode, I have a longer history with this particular subject. But as I was reading about, you know, Li Hongzhi and all of his dubious claims of magical abilities stemming from his sort of pseudo-martial art, I sort of stumbled upon some other really great examples of similar figures who, thankfully, for the most part, are not quite so embedded in far-right politics and potentially, like, CIA ops, but who have similarly duped the world with their proclaimed physical capabilities and sometimes, you know, sort of spiritual and energy powers.
Yeah, that's right, folks. We're talking about Steven Seagal.
Well, we actually are going to talk about Steven Seagal.
Nice.
Yeah, Steven Seagal is in this episode because he's, like, the most famous example and one that I can just discuss endlessly.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so... yeah, so we're just going to talk about some interesting characters and sort of the cultural foundations of where some of this comes from and why I find it so fascinating, and hopefully just have some laughs at the expense of some real
dingbats.
So, like I said, we're going to talk about, like, quack martial artists, and I'm not a martial artist, and I'm not some, like, you know, MMA dude. They love to kind of shit on anything that's not MMA, and for good reason, I guess. But I'm sure that the history of sort of fraudulent, sort of mythical, mystical, magical martial arts dudes goes back as old as martial arts go back, right? I do think that a lot of the controversy surrounding recent stuff wouldn't really be as known without, A, the explosion of the internet, where you can, like, just, like, find videotape of what some of these insane, like, masters are doing in their little strip mall dojos. Mm-hmm. But also, you know, with the rise of, you know, practical martial arts and mixed martial arts, suddenly you have a bunch of people who are actually diving into the science of, like, what works and what doesn't work, what is just fancy for, you know, the movies, and what would actually help you in a fight. And so, really, in some sense, it seems like the vast majority of martial arts outside of, like, the big four, which are, like, jiu-jitsu, Muay Thai, wrestling, and boxing, are at best practically ineffective, and at worst, like garbage mumbo-jumbo. Mm-hmm. You know, I know there's a lot of, like, really legitimate, like, old-school, like, karate schools and stuff that, like, you know, that's, like, legit, and it'll keep you physically fit and whatever, but... You know, unless you're fighting someone who has no idea what they're doing, it's probably not going to help you out much. But there are some schools of martial arts that kind of take things further than teaching, you know, dubious techniques that might not actually help you, into territory that gets, you know, gets super culty, super macho, and honestly just, like, downright hysterical. I spend a good deal of my time watching videos of, like, these chi masters and all their brainwashed, like, idiot students who are just like, oh my god, I could feel Sensei's energy. Like, yeah, I bet you could feel it.
Yeah, I did.
Coursing through your body. So, yeah, I mean, I think a lot of people have at least some degree of, like, firsthand experience with this. Like, I studied, you know, Kenpo karate in a strip mall. And it was...
Kenpo or Kenpo?
You see it spelled both ways.
Really? I've never seen it. Because, I did Kenpo.
Yeah, I think my school actually spelled it Kenpo, but... I don't know. You see it spelled both ways. In hindsight, it was, like, the hokiest shit ever. Like, I don't know what your experience was, but, like, looking back on it,
I hated it. That was my experience.
I ended up hating it, too, and I just, like, stopped, doing it, and they wouldn't progress me past, like, blue belt, I think, and finally...
Yeah, I got up to green, so...
Yeah, ooh.
Yeah, it was
what
pretty
you're saying
high.
Is you could take me.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. The next step was brown. You
know? Yeah.
And then after that, brown is one step before black belt.
Yeah. So. Yes, that's fewer degrees of separation from being a black belt. Yeah. Which is, I always laugh.
I could do my hook kicks. Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yep.
You could get that leg up there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, dude. Yeah, I could kick the shit out of some other kid in the chest.
Nice, dude. it's always funny, like, you walk into one of those dojos, and you see, like, you know, 8, 9, 10-year-old black belts, and it's like, how legit is that belt? What does that really represent, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Is that just because mom makes her payments on time? Like, it's...
Yeah, no, it was the same thing. Like, I barely knew what the fuck I was doing, and I was, like, a green belt, and I only did it for, like, 2 years, and there were kids that did it for, like, a year longer than me. They were, like, brown belts. Yep. And then, like, up to black belts until in, like, sixth grade. But, like, they were, like, I went to school and they were pussies.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I was like, this kid can't take anybody in a fight. Look at the fuck. Like, they call him a black belt, but that just, yeah. It just means that his parents are willing to pay, like, $120 a week.
I remember I worked at a P.F. Chang's when I was, like, 17. Yeah. And we had, you know, one of our managers was this guy, Chris, who was the nicest guy. Like, big dude, good sense of humor, was always, like, easygoing. And I remember one day, I used to smoke weed before work, like, just way too much. And
I did the same thing at that age.
Of course. And so, you know, I'm, like, at work, and I'm feeling giggly, and he starts talking about, the subject of martial arts come up, and he starts talking about how his son is a black belt. And he's like, yeah he's really good, you know, he knows his stuff. And I'm like, how old's your kid? And he's like, yeah, he's 12, you know, and he worked really hard, and you know, I'm really proud of him for, like, all the self-defense. I'm like, yeah, but... But you know it's not, like, a real black belt, though, right?
Yeah.
He goes, like, no, I mean, he did, like, his boards and his forms. I was like, yeah, but, like...
That's not a real
black belt. Well, and I said to him, I was like, yeah, but, like, I could fuck your son up, Chris. And he was like, I don't know, man. And I was like, Chris, he's a 12-year-old. I could fuck your kid up.
Yeah, you're, like, 6'4".
Anyway, whatever. Probably not a thing any father wants to hear from some idiot.
Like, a dude, like, a 6'4", 17-year-old, that's just like, I could kick the shit out of your 12-year-old son.
All I'm saying, dude, is if he's got something I want, I'm having it. If I want him... Anyway.
yeah.
So, whatever. So, like I said, I did it. Evan did it. I don't know about you, but nobody ever force-choked me. Like, I didn't have to, like... I wasn't one of those places, but they're way more prevalent than I realized, like, reading about this and watch. There are so many places where, like, that just quickly devolves into, like, yes, sensei has power over his chi, and he can deflect blows with his breath technique. I did have a guy named Hanshi, and that was his name, that was his title. He did talk about breath control a lot, how you should breathe with your belly. But anyway... I want to talk a little bit more about some of these Jedi Masters, because I think, you know, we obviously talked a lot about dark shit at the beginning, so I thought maybe some lighter material would be good. And, so we're going to talk about melted brain fucking Jedi Warriors.
Hell yeah.
So, when I was a kid, and I don't know, were you into, like, martial arts movies when you were a kid?
I mean, I loved Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Yes, definitely. Okay. So, that was my favorite type of stuff.
Yeah, like, you know, I wasn't, like a huge martial arts guy. Like, I definitely watched them. I liked them, you know, I liked Ong Bak, shit like that. So, like, I've always, like, liked them, but it's never been, like, my thing.
I definitely went through a pretty heavy phase. Like, I had a lot of... Like Jackie Chan and Bruce Lee movies and Jet Li.
Well, I got a lot of Bruce Lee movies now.
You do, yeah. but like Evan said, Crouching Tiger, that was like, they call that genre wuxia, right? And it was originally novels, but that's where you get really into where you see the people flying around on the treetops and running up walls.
Running across,
like
roofs
blocking
and walls and
arrows
stuff.
And...
spinning a bunch in the air like they're a figure skater.
And it's awesome. It's the coolest shit in the world.
Yeah, I mean, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon is a fucking awesome as shit
that's,
movie.
That's a perfect film. I love that movie. I've seen it so many times. Side note, if you've never seen it, like, and you think it's going to be some hokey thing, like, that's a beautiful film. You should definitely go watch it.
Yeah, shit fucks.
Also, like, at this point, you know, when I'm seeing, like, a lot of these movies, and particularly the more, like, quote-unquote realistic stuff, like, where it's not quite Crouching Tiger, it's more like, you know, Jet Li-type shit, which is still full of wires and mm-hmm. impossible or totally ridiculous techniques, but I didn't have access to, like, critiques of that, right? And so I had more of a sense that a lot of this stuff was, you know, like, more achievable, right? Like, seeing a little 5'2" dude, I forget what movie it is, but there's some Jet Li movie where, like, he gets, like, pushed into, like, a UFC cage and fucks up, like, five real UFC fighters and, like, you know, Tito Ortiz and whoever these guys were in the early 2000s. And in the movie, like, it, you know, they make it look good. Like, he, like, jacks these dudes up with the power of his, like, mystical ability. And now, since then, I saw an interview with him while I was, because I was trying to remember, I already forget what movie that was, but he was talking about it, and he was like, this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever done. He was like, any one of these guys would kill me in real life. I thought that was funny, because, you know, he obviously knows what he's capable of. I digress. But, you know, so I didn't have this sense that, like, these things were total bullshit, right? I didn't go into this just, like, skeptical of martial arts. But, you know, as I was taking my own classes, I realized that most of the, you know, karate masters or taekwondo masters running around are just, like, chubby older dudes with weird hair. And, you know, they are more focused on kind of looking good in competition and, you know, breaking boards and silly shit. And it's just not, you know, as mystical, magical as maybe I wanted it to be.
Yeah.
I still enjoy those films, but, you know, it kind of shatters the illusion of that sort of mystical kung fu power. But my first sort of run-in with, like culty karate is there was this little, I guess, dojo in my hometown. And it was mm-hmm. on one of the main, like, routes through the center of, like, the business district of town. And it always caught my eye because they had this big, like, sign. And it said, Grandmaster Iron King's Academy of Umyeongdo. Which is, like, I'm like, I've never heard of that. I mean, the guy who taught me Kenpo was named Craig. So, mm-hmm. you see somebody named Grandmaster.
Yeah, mine was Steve. My sensei was Steve.
So, who do you take in a, you know, you're a kid and you're, like, choosing who's going to teach you to fight. You take Steve and Craig, or do you take Grandmaster Iron Kim?
Yeah.
You pick that guy. Like, yeah. That's the guy that you think knows the real mystical
Iron
secrets
Kim,
of the
Iron Kim, dude.
Grandmaster Iron Kim.
Yeah, Iron Kim, Grandmaster of the Umyeongdo.
So, Grandmaster Iron Kim, I became kind of, like, obsessed with the idea of, I wanted to go there, but, you know, my parents had just spent all this money for me to do Kenpo with Craig, and I didn't stick to it, so they're like, no, we're not paying for you to go to this, and so I kind of get over it.
Grandmaster Iron Kim style.
Yep. So we're gonna dive into this a little bit, because Grandmaster Iron Kim is a trip, but when I was older, I, like, remembered it, and I kind of looked it up, and this is, like, when I was in college, and I think this is, like, my first real McDojo experience.
Yeah.
Side note, like, shout out to, there's a really great YouTube channel and Instagram account called McDojo Life. Mick, like, McDonald's Dojo Life.
Yeah, you've been steady following that for, like, 10 years.
No, like 2 years, but they
way more than two, dude. It is way before COVID that you were sending me McDojo Life shit.
Okay, well, COVID, you know, maybe since 2018.
Way before.
That's, like, 4 years, Evan.
Way before.
I don't even have an active Instagram account 10 years ago.
Yes, but you did. Then you deleted it, and then you got a new one.
Oh, that was 10 years ago?
Yeah, dude.
Damn. Whatever, dude.
It was like 2012, bro.
Well, I didn't know about it back then. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
But that's a super awesome page where they highlight a lot of the silly stuff, and they'll show, like, you know, a lot of these, like, chi warriors, like, somebody will come up and try to punch them, and they just, like, hold up their hand, and then suddenly the guy, like, has a seizure and collapses. So everybody's playing along. But they also highlight, like, other stuff, like abusive practices of karate instructors. Because there's also a lot of, like, martial arts instructors, I should say, who, you know, will just, like, full contact beat the shit out of their students and, like, claim that it's, like, part of their training. And you're just like, you just like to fuck up kids, don't you? But at least, I guess that's more constructive than some other things. I don't know.
Dude, I just like, so this Iron Kim, you can tell this dude is off on his own over here because he's just wearing, like, various, in some of these pictures.
Oh, you scrolled straight down?
Yeah, he's just straight up in tracksuits.
Yeah.
And some of posing. These pictures, just standing, like, in his backyard.
Yeah.
Like, next to his pool.
He's, like, out in, like, he's, in some of them, he's, like, on a rock in what looks like a quaint Asian forest. But then, yeah,
and
in
with
others,
pictures
he's just, like,
of that have maybe 4 pixels total.
Yeah, they're old. This website's been the same for a long time. It's
and
exactly
you can tell
the same
only
as
only other person nearby is the one taking the picture.
Mm-hmm. He might even have a camera set up on a tripod.
Maybe he.
But so, whatever, regardless. So, the first thing about Grandmaster Iron Kim, so we're going to kind of talk a little bit about the webpage here. right off the bat, the first thing it says is, over the centuries, very few individuals have ever achieved Grandmaster Iron Kim's level of skill and ability. Many say how good they are, but the true measure of skill and ability can only be seen through demonstration. Since 1972, millions of people in the United States have benefited from traditional Mudo. And then there's this picture, which is always the picture they show, of him doing this, like, I mean, he's doing, like, a pretty sweet-looking jumping side kick. And that's, like, his signature move. And they say that. And so this picture, right, it's reportedly shows him doing a side kick off the edge of, I think this is either an 18 or a 9-story building. They talk about him doing both and landing on the ground completely unscathed. But also what he's apparently able to do is he's able to, well, so I guess they call that the ability of doing this, like, side kick at any distance. He calls it Kyong Gong Sul Bop. So they say he jumped off an 11-story building and then did it again on an 8-story building, landing uninjured.
What I really like is that in this picture, they conveniently crop out the building that he's on.
Well, so they say, they're like, you can see in the very bottom corner, the corner of the building, on the lower corner of the roof, but there's no, who knows?
There's no indication. He could very well just be kind of like on a hill,
yeah,
which down the hill is another building. Because there is a building in the background. They and I think about, this is framed just a way to look like, wow, it looks like he's jumping from a building just as high as that other one. But there's some tricky work going on here.
Yeah. So the way that they describe his jump kick, which I think is the Kyong Gong Sul Bop, and something else called Nae Gong, they claim that he can jump straight up in the air, while in the air, locate the direction and target that he wants to attack, extend his leg, and then that's why he's got his arms out in front of him like he's casting a spell. He's extending mm-hmm. his chi energy and deciding which direction his body is going to move. Does that make sense? So he claims to be able to jump straight in the air, put his leg out, and then choose a direction and fly in that direction.
That dude, can you teach me that?
Because well, that's a Street Fighter move. Like he's, and that's why all the pictures are of him doing jump kicks. Because he says, like, I can jump straight up, and I can shoot in any direction I want.
That I will is, honestly, dude, respect.
Yeah,
that fucking rules.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. And I actually just lost the page here. There's, oh come on, I'm using my trackpad right now. It's the absolute worst. So yeah, just in case there's any weird sound shit this episode, I'm recording from my parents' house. I am hanging here. I had to come up this way to get my car fixed, which, as I'm sure you all know, is the best shit ever. So if you scroll down, Evan, below all the pictures of all the people,
body transformation.
There's a really great
strength.
There's like this
shatter.
You can look at a few of Grandmaster Iron Kim's achievements. At the age of 7, Grandmaster Iron Kim began his life's path in the study and practice of martial arts. To achieve perfection of his martial arts movements, Grandmaster Iron Kim many times chose the solitude of the mountain and ocean areas of Asia, just Asia, to practice the forms and techniques that he learned. Although he learned from many qualified teachers, a majority of the knowledge that Grandmaster Iron Kim possesses was passed down through Grandmaster Wang Po, the seventh generation Grandmaster of Yin Yang Do. The whole thing with Umyang Do, he claims to be a master of 8 different martial arts, and he teaches you all of them, and then you can, like, move your body with chi energy. He also claims to be in 1956, he competed in the All-Asia Championship, which, you know, I'm sure no one's ever heard of, and was proclaimed uncontested champion of All-Asia after besting all other, comers. He also claims to be able... There's some move that he can do. I forget what this is. What do they say? Oh, well, doesn't really matter.
I really like the title, just Uncontested Champion of All Asia.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, it says, of the hundreds of millions of people who practice martial arts in the 20th century, Grandmaster Iron Kim is one of fewer than 10 practitioners that has achieved unprecedented fame and recognition for being the most skilled in Mudo. Mudo just, I guess, means, like, martial arts. But he just has all these, like, whack statistics. So, whatever. We don't need to go on about this particular guy forever, because I want to talk about a couple other things here. But this is just, like, the first of these, like, weird schools that I, like, learned about. And it's not there anymore, but it happened to be in my hometown. And then, of course, you know, you read all these other stories about Umyang Do, and everybody's like, oh, no, it's a cult. Like, this dude's nuts. Like, I don't know how to fight. I just got hazed the whole time I was there. It's a wicked big scam. All the people there are fucking insane. They, like, worship this dude. So, you know, that's sort of the general gist of what I'm trying to get across. They give up this idea that, like, yeah, I'm actually probably, like, one of the 10 best fighters in the world, and, you know, I wouldn't call it magic, but I can do some pretty incredible things with my body. So,
Yeah, I can just jump in the air and then sort of, you know, I have like a targeting system that I'm able to access, and I just point myself and I'm fired like a howitzer at my target, feet first.
I get blasted out like a cannon, bro.
Yeah, dude.
Here, give me 1 second.
This dude rolls, I like him.
Yeah, he's awesome. So, let's see here. Ba-ba-ba.
Also, I just scrolled down and realized that the picture that's at the top is what you said before. It shows a little bit more where you can see the corner of roof.
Yeah.
Where it points to it, and then, just in case you were still confused, they put an R in a circle over this, like, tiny little corner of, like, concrete.
Ay-yay-yay.
It's hilarious. Corner of roof, you can see here, labeled R.
For roof.
Yeah.
So obviously, you know, this is not as many people have heard of Grandmaster Iron Kim, but it was just sort of like my first example of one of these like crazy magical sensei type figures, and it definitely sort of piqued my interest in this sort of thing, right? The idea that, like, do people really believe this? Like, because most normal people, I feel like you look at this page and you're not gonna buy it. You're just gonna be like, there's no way this dude can like change directions mid jump and do all this shit. Like, he looks like a frail old man. Like, I don't know. But people do. People buy into it. People will believe kind of anything. But it goes way beyond, like, these, like, my little hometown weirdo in Anywheresville, Massachusetts. You know, there are people that are, you know, relatively successful that are this same level of cracked in the head. Um, And I say relatively because, as we said at the start of the episode, you know, Steven Seagal is one of the all-time great bullshit artists. And also a noted sexual predator. Apparently,
many times alleged.
Yeah, from like '96 through
up to and
now.
Including sexual slavery.
Yeah, yeah, and I mean we're not gonna go too much into that because I want to kind of try to keep it light today. But he's a piece of shit. Yeah. So if you're familiar with Steven Seagal, you probably know him as the guy with the weird ponytail who like looks like the least likely action film star ever. Like,
and would you believe it? His action movies have almost no action.
Yeah, I mean, some of them do. Like, Under Siege is actually like pretty okay. I think it's his only movie with a positive rating on Rotten Tomatoes, and it's like a 60%. Yeah. It's like barely a red tomato.
Yeah, he was pretty famous for his films in the '90s, having like 10 to 20 total minutes of fighting over like 90+ minute runtimes.
Yeah, and it's less now because like
he can't even get out of a chair.
Do anything. But he claims to, like, you know, consult MMA fighters and, like, teach them how to do special techniques and stuff. He made a string of shitty
kick somebody in the shins.
But so his initial claim to fame is as an Aikido master. And so, like, say all you want. I know, like, MMA dudes, like, shit on Aikido and it doesn't, like, work, whatever. But it is, like, a legitimate, quote-unquote, martial art that's, like, old. And he really is, like, a seventh Dan black belt, whatever that means, in Aikido. And so it's not that he's, like, lying about knowing any martial arts, but, and in fact, he was actually the first American to be allowed to conduct classes in Aikido in Japan. So, you know, within that community, he was at one point considered, like, a respected member. But the thing about him is that he's also, like, batshit insane. He claims to have been a CIA asset, which at this point, like, I just believe. He said that he was, like, brought in to do, like, secret covert ninja missions for, like, the CIA and the FBI before he ever was famous. And he's legitimately, like, boys with Vladimir Putin. He's got dual or triple U.S., Serbian, and Russian citizenship. Claims that, you know, Putin's the greatest leader of all time. And he's a huge bullshit slinger. One of the things
you gotta talk about Jean LaBelle. This is, like, the best story on earth.
So Jean LaBelle is, like, an example of sort of the opposite end of the spectrum. Jean LaBelle was a famous early practitioner of judo and, I think, jiu-jitsu, and, which are, you know, among the more legitimate, practical martial arts, and, like, wrestling and boxing. And he was just, like, a tough dude. I think they called him Mean Jean LaBelle. And so his career involved a lot of stunt work and stunt coordination for movies, like choreographing fights, but also doing, when he was younger, doing a lot of that stuff. Yeah. So look him up. I mean, he was much more of a real deal type of guy. And so he was working as, I think, a stunt coordinator on one of these early Seagal movies. Now, I guess Steven Seagal is infamous for, like, working stiff, which is, like, a wrestling term, but he likes to actually hit stuntmen when he's doing fights. And he, like, won't pull punches.
Yeah, he notoriously mistreats them.
Yeah, he, like, tries to physically hurt. So just to show that he's a tough guy. Meanwhile, these are people that are deliberately not responding because they're in a movie.
Because their job depends on it.
Right, and they're well-adjusted individuals.
Yeah, it's also like, it's like a power dynamic situation where he can beat the shit out of other people. But if they fight back, he would, like, immediately fire them.
Yeah.
You know
what
I mean?
So LaBelle finds out that he's been, like, being too rough with his guys on this set, and previously, like, Seagal reportedly had been walking around set and making all kinds of claims. Like, he knew that Jean LaBelle was, like, a submission guy, like a judo fighter and a jiu-jitsu guy. And so Seagal had claimed, like, well, as a seventh Dan Aikido master, you become physically immune to being choked out. Like, you couldn't choke me out if you tried. And so LaBelle's, like, all pissed off at him because he hears he's being an asshole. And so he's like, I mean, we can try. Like, you willing to demo that?
Well, and, allow me to retort.
Yeah. And so, you know, he gets Seagal to agree to it. He puts him in a hold. And then Seagal's like, all right, go. And so Jean LaBelle does. And he, like, applies, like, this triangle choke. And he proceeds to just immediately choke Steven Seagal the fuck out. And the best part is that, like, the second he loses consciousness, apparently he just, like, shits his pants.
Yeah.
And so in front of, like, all the stunt guys, Jean LaBelle just, like, jacks him up and he just, like, craps his pants on set.
Well, so it was funny, too. Like, after that, he was, like, still talking shit. And I think it was Ronda Rousey who had, like, learned from Jean LaBelle.
Yeah.
Like, said that she offered to choke him out again so he can shit his pants a second time.
Right, because, yeah, she had studied under James, under Jean LaBelle.
How about I choke him out and he can shit his pants in front of everybody again?
So, the cool thing about this story, or one of the cool things, is Jean LaBelle, like, kind of immediately distanced himself from it, because he felt like the fact that this was, like, a thing made him look bad, that he, like, stooped to the level of using his legitimate techniques on this, like, poser. He's, like, he felt like he, like, stooped too low. And meanwhile, Steven Seagal is like, he's a no good lying piece of shit.
He was called him a liar.
He's like, I have irrefutable evidence from an eyewitness that would disprove the whole thing, which of course just like has never been. And there's like 40 people that say they were there and we're like,
okay, well, there's like 40 eyewitnesses that say that you fucking shit your pants, bro.
And it's funny,
that
like,
you like fully filled your pants up.
Jean LaBelle, who I don't think is still alive, but he was until pretty recently, or maybe he is. I don't know. He's old. Mm-hmm. But, his stance on it now is basically like, listen, like, it's sort of just like, he fucked around and found out. Like, if you're going to be a loudmouth around people that actually know what they're doing, that might get you hurt, and I think Steven now knows that. But, yeah, anyway. So, can you still hear me?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, I just got a weird feedback in my headphones. So that was my
chi reaching out through the microphone.
Yeah.
I was committing, mental warfare on you.
So, this is actually where my notes kind of crap out, but there's really only a few other things that I wanted to kind of talk about. Because, as I've said, like, this is stuff that still goes on, and the great part about it is that, like, in the internet age, we have, like, through things like McDojo Life, we have, you can watch all this stuff, and it's just great. And one of the most famous people right now, have you seen this guy, the guy who runs DUST, Detroit Urban Survival Training?
No.
Or Survival Tactics. So he's a black guy, and he wears, like, this, like, wannabe kind of tactical cops uniform.
Yeah, yeah.
And his big claim to fame is that he shows people ways to survive, like, someone pulling a gun on you and, like, pulling a knife on you. But he pulls these insane maneuvers that just, like, you would just get shot if you tried to do any of this, right? And so that's sort of the other more dangerous side of it, is that not only are you, like, kind of being a charlatan and tricking people and profiting off of, like, lying about what you're able to do, but some of these people, you know, if they're actively, like, teaching folks and, like, selling these skills as marketable self-defense techniques, you're gonna get someone killed. And so this guy, I forget his name, but the DUST guy, he's been called on it numerous times, and people, like, try to replicate his stuff with, like, prop guns, and just 100% of the time, like, it ends up with the person being, you know, quote-unquote shot. And there's all sorts of stuff like this. Like, if you go out and you tell someone that, like, you can deflect an attacker who's coming at you with a knife by using your body's internal energy, that person's gonna get stabbed. And then they're gonna be really probably upset with you for all the thousands of dollars you spent. You know, and God forbid you're on tape using your mumbo jumbo, and then someone sticks a knife in your ribs. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So anyway, it's also just like a dangerous thing to do. The last and possibly greatest of these characters that I really want to talk about is a guy who was really big. Actually, hold on one second here. A guy who was really big.
What I really like about this is all of these guys could be, like, different Tim Heidecker characters or something.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. These guys would all work in that kind of
bullshit artist territory.
Yeah, yeah. So the last guy that I want to talk about, and wow, we're actually, like, hitting an hour, quote-unquote, the deadliest man alive, a man who was born John Timothy Kean in 1939, but became most famous as Count Juan Rafael Dante. A famous actual practitioner of martial arts who made a name for himself. Did you look him up?
Count Juan Rafael Dante.
Yeah. So, there's all kinds of crazy shit about him. But he is one of
if the... If nothing else, he came up with, like, the greatest bullshit artist name ever.
Yeah, yeah. So his what made him famous is that he started... he became well-known for posting these insane advertisements in, like, the backs of comic books. And he was the master of a school called the Black Dragon Fighting Society, which claims to teach the deadliest forbidden martial arts on Earth. Anybody who knows about any of this, like, mumbo-jumbo martial arts stuff has probably heard of Dim Mak. Dim Mak is one of the many names for, like, the famous secret death touch. If you've seen Kill Bill, the five-point palm exploding heart technique, way better name. But there's all these sort of...
Or if you're a fan of bro metal, five-finger death punch.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I think that's probably based on the same thing.
I think it comes from the from Kill Bill.
I think so, too. I mean, that's a sweet name. If you knew how to do something called the five-point palm exploding heart technique, I mean, that's...
Great.
That's awesome. But so this guy claims that he did. He called it Dim Mak, and he claimed that by attacking you with a certain amount of force at certain points in your body, he could paralyze you or kill you with a single strike. And he is sort of like the origin point of a lot of these other guys, because he was around a lot earlier. He was a legitimate karate black belt at a time when karate was, and martial arts in general, were very new to the U.S. And by all accounts, in his early years, he was, you know, respected by his peers. He really did devote himself to getting himself in really good physical shape, getting himself to a point where he was really confident in performing legitimate martial arts, but he was also, like, a massive narcissist and, like, potentially a sociopath, and became obsessed with running, like, really intense full-contact martial arts tournaments. And this was in the Chicago, Illinois area. He claimed that his love for full-contact fighting came from time that he spent fighting in top-secret kumite tournaments, death matches in Asia. He claimed to have killed, like, 30 guys, most of them with his bare hands. And he said that, you know, he'd spent all this time fighting in these death matches and realized, like, the true potential of the fighting deadly arts and wanted to bring that back to the United States. He was, like, an even less realistic version of the evil Cobra Kai sensei and Karate Kid. So he's like he encourages his students to, like, be aggressive and beat up on each other, and he did this really awesome stunt, like, early in his career. And by the way, once he changed his name to Count Dante, he claimed it was because his family had escaped from imperialist Spain you know, decades before, and were forced to change their name so they wouldn't be hunted down by, like, the king's royal assassins, but that he was, you know, actually a count, and his name was Juan Rafael Dante. He had the best beard you've ever fucking seen, also.
Oh, yeah, I'm looking at it right now.
It's wild.
Yeah, swag.
Yeah, yeah. But so he had performed a stunt early in his career where he had, you know, his own dojo, and he was really trying to, like, get a name for himself. And so he said he went down to, like, one of the local butchers. Everybody knows Chicago is, or definitely was, in, like, the 60s still, like, the meatpacking capital of the country. So he goes and buys a live bull, and he claims that using his secret death touch technique, this bull is going to get killed in front of a live stage audience to demonstrate the power of his ability. He's not going to do it, though. He's going to have one of his, like, brown belts do it. And so he convinces this kid, it's like a 17-year-old kid, he's like, you are going to show the power of my amazing techniques by killing a bull with your bare hands with one strike. And the kid's like, I can do that? And he goes, yeah, you can. And so this kid gets all amped up, and he's like, fuck yeah, I'm going to fucking kill this bull with my techniques. He's, like, practicing his strikes and whatever. And meanwhile, Dante's, like, driving around town, and he's, like, advertising. He's talking through, like, a bullhorn with big signs, like, come this date, this time, whatever. You're going to see me, my student, fucking kill this bull. And so he gets the place packed full, and then, of course, is like, no, the bull, the bull, the the local animal cruelty agency called the police, and they repossessed the bull at the last minute. So it can't happen. It was never going to fucking happen, obviously. But yeah, he had all these people's attention.
I was worried that this was going to end up with the kid getting killed by a bull.
Well, it would have. If he put a kid in a ring with a bull and told him to slap it, that kid would have gotten killed. But no, he was never going to have the kid try to hit a bull. It was just all marketing, right? And so he became known for that. He would put these insane advertisements in... and I want to use one of them as the image, so you guys will all see the image for this episode. They're just wild, you know? All the secrets of the ancient Far Eastern fighting arts will be yours if you study Dante, which is what he called his style.
I see. Yeah. The Dante system.
Yeah, yeah. And, I mean... Also, he did know karate, but the other big thing about him that was really cool is what's called the dojo wars. He had this habit of like really trying to stir up conflict between his Black Dragon fighting society and other local martial arts schools. And one in particular that he had like a real problem with was this place that had an even better name. They were called the Green Dragon Society's Black Cobra Hall.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so the group is the Green Dragon Society and their dojo is the Black Cobra Hall. So he decided he wanted to do a dojo storm or a dojo assault, which is like a real thing, and that used to be kind of more common, like, you know, 100 years ago, 200 years ago in Asia. Schools would fight each other to try to prove, like, which system was better. All very kind of tacky, but he gets, like, a few of his guys, most of whom are, like, 17, whatever, and they storm this dojo, and the only other adult who's with him is this guy named Jim Konsevic, who's also, you know, a sensei, karate sensei, in his sort of circle of friends. And they run in. They claim to be police officers, so they get let in the front door. And then they just start fucking shit up. They start, like, breaking the place, challenging everybody to one-on-one fights. And in the midst of this, everybody's so freaked out that one of the instructors at the Black Cobra Hall takes a samurai sword off the wall and fucking stabs Jim Konsevic in the stomach and, like, fucking kills him. God. And he bleeds out on the floor and dies. So, of course, they run away, and Count Dante gets brought up on charges and is ultimately acquitted. The judge is like, it's everybody's fault. What are you idiots doing? You shouldn't be fighting like this. But whatever. Also, his defense lawyer in that trial is a guy named Robert Cooley, who's a famous former mob lawyer. So Count Dante is like a minor blip on the radar in his story, but he defended him in his trial. And he also is convinced that that Count Dante was the mastermind behind the 1974 Chicago Purolator vault robbery, where $4.3 million was stolen from this... what was it? Water purification? I don't remember. But there was this famous, at the time, like, million-dollar heist in Chicago, and Robert Cooley intimated that... because at this point, what's his name? Count Dante had died. He died in, like, 1976. He had an ulcer. He died... He had an ulcer in his stomach, and he bled to death and died. Yep. And so after he was dead, his lawyer was like, yeah, I'm pretty sure he was the guy behind that bank heist.
Damn.
So, yeah, he was just, like, a wild and crazy guy who...
He rules.
Yeah, he rules pretty hard. Anyway, I don't even really know where I'm going with this, but Count Dante's a man. You should look him up. He was my favorite sort of character that I uncovered in this. And you really have to see what he looks like. I've never seen anybody that looks like this guy.
Yeah, he is insane. He is a strange-looking cat.
You know what he looks like? He looks like... the Hardy Boys from WWE, like, if they were around in, like, the 60s, you know? He's got, right.
Or he looks like anybody that, like, he's like a LeVayan type guy.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, just like or,
and he has very much that whole, like, aesthetic that, like, you see with, like, process church stuff.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. Yeah, he's got very, like, real, like, Hot Topic vibes, real edgelord vibes.
Yeah.
And anyway.
The coolest fucking ads on Earth. Like,
Oh, they're awesome. They're awesome. Well, I try to find a way to show you guys some of them, because they're, or just, I mean, whatever, you're adults, you can look them up. Count Dante, and they'll come right up.
This guy rules.
Yeah, he's pretty fucking sweet. So yeah, I mean, I guess the moral of the story here, beyond just like telling funny anecdotes about weirdos who pretend they can do magical kung fu, I think that this is really indicative of like a bigger, legitimate systemic problem wherein like we've got a society wherein some of our most vulnerable and most gullible people are constantly being hoodwinked into spending money and basically joining these cults, and then they get themselves in a situation where, like I said, if somebody actually pulls a gun on you and you think that you're, you know, a gold belt in magical chi manipulation, or that you've like learned the secret technique to pull a gun out of someone's hands before they shoot you, you're gonna end up dead, and you know, the blood is sort of on these people's hands who perpetrate this ridiculous sort of belief. Just stick to the movies, and if you want to learn how to fight, like, learn how to box, you know? It's that shit works. Like, just learn how to throw like a diesel punch, and
yeah, most people don't know how to fight, so if you do, you can knock them out.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, one time I watched a like a 5'5" little dude who used to be a regular at one of my bars knock out a dude who was probably 3 inches taller and 50 pounds heavier than me. Big biker dude, knocked him out in about 6 seconds because he was a former Gold Gloves amateur boxer. And it's like, big dude looked tough. You would have never taken this little guy in the fight, but it was like nothing I've ever seen before. He just fucking just rocked him, not, you know, wiped the floor with him. And it was a sight to see. So, on that note, I think that's pretty much it. I think that's pretty much all I got, and we're getting close to an hour and 10.
It's getting pretty late, so.
Yeah. Thank you guys for listening. Evan, is there anything you wanted to add off topic? Any last thoughts, or?
Let me try and think. Oh! No.
All right. Well, if you do, let me know. We can.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I feel like there's a stupid thing I wanted to bring up, but I do not remember, so. Okay. We'll do this again in a week.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Well, thanks, guys. As always, you'll find contact information and whatever in our show notes. And thank you for listening. And we're glad to be back doing this. And I hope that you guys liked hearing about these dummies. And but also, thanks for
keep spreading the word about us.
Yeah, please do. All right, guys. Well, we will see you next week. This has been another episode of Left on Red. See ya.
Peace. Return to innocence.